they are continue on the next way, let's say for the SMA patients that you have the 90 or so, are they, I imagine that the treatment will continue for those, but for in next years, will it continue or not, and that decided on the price of the...
Once the medication is in the basket, it's forever. It's in the basis of the budget. This allocation of 460 million shekels is to the base of the budget, and it continues forever.
And new patients are also...
Yes. You can ask how drugs or medications are eliminated from the basket. And the answer to this is that if there is, for a certain disease, a medication that is significantly more efficacious than a previous medication, and it's included in the basket, when we calculate the sum of money that has to be allocated for the new medication, we deduct the cost of the old medication, and we even have nomograms. How long, how many years does it take for a medication that is replaced by a better one to be totally discarded and not used by physicians? And I have many examples, but we don't have time for that.
Okay. And not for Dr. Tovar. Yes. You mentioned that when in fact you have with genistein, it's very, but have you tested if it has antimicrobial activity and in the concentration that you're using?
So you mean what happens if we use antibiotics? No.
If genistein has antimicrobial activity against
something? No, we have not tried that. Something that we have tried is, and we are doing some experiments, is there are a lot of studies looking for the health benefits of the consumption of soy protein. But when we provide antibiotics to the animals, some of these effects, they disappear. So it seems like the gut microbiota is involved in some of these changes. So, that's the only thing.
Max Schmulzon from the UNAM, Institute of Medical Research. I have a question for Dr. Goren. Very nice talk, by the way. Regarding your experiments where you transplanted stools from a pregnant woman in her first month of pregnancy compared to the transplantation of her third month of pregnancy, you showed that there was an increase of weight in the rats. So, of course, you were trying to say that there's a change in the microbiota that may be related to the fact that kids that are born or babies that are born from a C-section compared to those from a vaginal born, they have a different microbiota. But I would like you to expand a little bit more on the significance of that increase in weight of the rats that were transplanted with stools of the mother in her third month of pregnancy. Are you saying that there's a change in the stool microbiota also during the pregnancy that may be related to even increasing in weight of the mother?
Okay. So yes, we're actually just wrapping up a project exactly on this. So the microbiota changes very dramatically in pregnancy. We know that even if we imitate certain conditions of pregnancy in mice. For example, in mice, you can do pseudo-pregnancy, so get a mouse, a female mouse, to think and act as if it's pregnant without being pregnant. You see the weight gain, you see the hormonal changes, you see the inflammatory changes, and you see the bacterial changes. We can imitate using hormones. And this is something that we're working on right now. We can imitate pregnancy, you know, the levels of hormones in pregnancy, and see exactly the same changes in these mice receiving hormones as in pregnant mice.
Bueno.
Even more than that, we can do cultures of bacteria, certain bacteria that we see going up, and see that they react to certain hormones in pregnancy. So, yes, I think bacteria change in pregnancy for a reason, And that reason is to maintain a healthy pregnancy and to maintain the right transfer to the offspring.
So translating this into clinical practice or into daily life, are you saying that probably in the future maybe some kind of probiotics will be helpful during a pregnancy for the mother and in the development of the baby?
In the future. I mean, I think today that the probiotic world is a bit problematic.
Correct.
But I think we are, now that we understand that, and a lot of us are trying to fix it, we will see exactly that. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, congratulations, those are great talks. But for Dr. Omri Goren, how do you know what is the future for the autism spectrum disorders and microbiota?
For autism?
Yeah.
Okay. So there are several studies looking at the microbiome of children with autism. They're not very controlled for, so they don't all agree with it. There's even one study that did fecal transplants. So basically gave kids with autism feces from healthy individuals and showed improvement. But again, it wasn't very well controlled for with placebo. We are now involved in a very big study to first identify the microbiome of autistic children. And if we will see a change, then we will move forward to fecal transplants. But today we know there is a change, but we're not exactly sure what it means, especially because these kids also have very special dietary preferences. You know, some of them won't eat certain foods. So we see a connection, and we don't really understand it.
Hi, I'm Roni Apte from Ben Gurion University in Israel. I want to congratulate all speakers of this session. It was very interesting for me to know how the health basket is divided in Israel. But I have a question for the microbiome people. We are actually individuals, so each of us contains different microbes that change under different conditions. Let's say we are not mice or rats and so on and so forth. So I assume that you have a lot of changes, in the microbiome in healthy subject versus different diseases, and in the different diseases you have probably variation between individual patient and so on. So I would like to hear your opinion about what will be the trend of subsequent research. Will we go for identifying the bacteria or for identifying the metabolomics and look for products that the bacteria produce and give those products as substitutes to the diet?
Well, first of all, I consider that this field of gut microbiota, we are still in the surface and we are understanding a little bit more. I think that for me, something that is important is you have bacteria, that these bacteria, they are doing something to the organism. They are modifying a lot of molecules that we are consuming in the diet. And these bacteria are providing signals to our organism for different changes. We don't know all the signals, and I think this research will take many years in the future to understand exactly what is happening. But the only thing that I understand is that I knew that I was understanding more or less well biochemistry and metabolism, and with this field of gut microbiota, everything is changing. There are some other actors, some new molecules, some new interactions, and we have to explore that. And for us, diet is the number one thing that we should study in order to provide a beneficial effect for people with different diseases. And finally, I think that something that we need to understand more is what is the relationship between genetics, individual persons, and the gut microbiota that we have, because there is an interaction.
Están pasando por aquí las indicaciones de que ya es tiempo de salir al café, y vamos a cortar el tiempo del café, vamos a dar 10 minutos para el café. Y muchas gracias por estar en esta sesión, y yo creo que fue muy interesante.
Thank you. Gracias.